For I am so we exalt you. Just sing it out from your heart. Let it flow. I exalt you. We exalt you tonight, Father. Father, tonight we thank you. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you, Father, that you are the same God yesterday, today, and forevermore. We thank you tonight that we can rest in your presence. I thank you tonight that every person in this building tonight, Father, my cry is take us deeper. Our heart's cry is, Father, here is more. Our heart's cry is, Father, we are not satisfied. We are hungry and thirsty for you. Father, this evening is all about you. We want to come afresh, lay ourselves down. Afresh, Father, I pray that fires will be ignited in hearts tonight. I pray, Father, that the restoration will take place at a level that we will see the fruit in the next couple of days. I pray, Father, I even speak that things that used to take long, the breakthrough is now. I even pray and speak that people that have come here, some of them, some of you, maybe you don't know why you're here, but God has an appointment. And he's about to do something in your life. I thank you for the word suddenly that I see now being released on us, Father. Suddenlies, suddenlies, suddenlies. In the mighty name of Jesus. And in this moment, Father, we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. There's truly no one like you. And we all say, amen and amen and amen. My goodness. Good evening. Trust you all are doing well. For me, this is probably the most difficult platform to ever preach on because this is the church where I grew up. So I can tell you many stories about this church. Still when we had these couches with the golden pillows. Now those were good couches. If you are a businessman, you can make money from those couches. Because that angle was just situated in such a position that when you have loose money or loose change in your pocket, when you sit on those degrees, on that angle, after the service, you can just stick your hands into the pillows and you will find some treasures. Hallelujah. So this church has been good to me, and in this church, many memories, good and bad, and I'm so grateful to be here. I'm grateful that you've come tonight. I just want to honor Pastor Herman. He was my pastor when I was young. I cannot remember a lot because I was very young, but I know I've got some hidings from him. But we are standing here. And what an honor and a privilege to stand on this platform this I'm almost said this morning. It's such an honor and a privilege for me. And I felt when we announced this trip, we just decided Wednesday evening, me and my wife, we're standing on the scripture, Matthew chapter number 5, that says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. So I don't know about you, but I'm hungry. I don't know about you, but I'm thirsty. So if you're here tonight, I want you to get an expectation. I want you to get your hunger level up, because God is about to meet you tonight. And I'm grateful you've come. Just hold on. Maybe I'll tell a story or two, but let's see what God wants to do tonight. I'm in Kimberley. This means it's payback. I remember when I started off in ministry, I said, Lord, what must I do? He said, preach the gospel in every province. I said, why? He said, because you've been naughty in every province. So it's payback time. We've got some unfinished business. And I really believe tonight God's going to do something specific. I've got a word burning. We'll see where we go. Normally I go here a little and I go there a little and we see what comes out. Is that all right? Are you hungry? There at the back, can I hear you? Hier in Kimberley, preek ons terug. Ons sê amen. Ons sê hallelujah. So I'll work on my English a little bit tonight, but we'll see what happens. And this evening I'm preaching in my hometown, and many of you know me, so I really feel that I'm going to be vulnerable and just speak on some of my journey and some experiences that I had, because I really feel this is going to bless us. Are you with me? So I want to quickly lay down a foundation, which I believe is very important. This is the one thing that I have learned and I am learning every day of my life. And I want to read this passage, and then I'm going to speak from that, and we'll see where we go from that. Is she nog okay? So the Bible says, I'm going to read English, because when I had my first encounter, I was handed an English Bible. So I just want to thank Miss Voss from a word called Diamantveld. She didn't help me a lot because I wasn't there a lot. So I had to work a little harder to read the words and to get there. But by the grace of God, by the grace of God, I'm standing here. Hallelujah. So the Bible says something in Ephesians chapter number 14. I want to read this and show you something. This is the foundation of everything. The other day, someone asked me, are you going to preach about the love of Jesus again? I said, yes. Every single time, I'm going to preach about the love of Jesus. So the Bible says in verse number 14, this is Paul, and he's praying in this moment. And he says, for this reason, he says, I bow my knee before the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So this is an important matter. He's going to his knees. Then he says this, verse number 15, he says, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named. How many of you know that you have a name? How many of you know that you're part of a family? Do you know why you have a name? Because there is an inheritance. The enemy can only produce orphans. He's an orphan himself. He can never have a name again. There is an inheritance. The reason you have a name is because only when you have a name, you can access an inheritance. And by the name, by the way, you serve a name. And at the mention of that name, every knee shall bow. Every tongue shall confess that Jesus is the King. Jesus is the Lord. Hallelujah. Now he goes further. He says, Father, that you would grant to them according to your riches and your glory. So this is something that he possesses. And Paul says, this is so important. Father, you have to give this to them. They need this. What do we need? It says, to be strengthened with might through the Holy Spirit in the inner man. This is so important. He says that you might be strengthened. Father, give them strength in the inner man through the Holy Spirit. In the Amplified, it says that you will be enforced, reinforcements coming to you. And then it says something beautiful. It says, Himself indwelling your innermost being and your personality. Do you know that God wants to use your personality? You know, the most negative comments I get on social media is when I operate out of my personality. It's that moment the anointing comes upon me and I begin to get extravagant. They say, you cannot shout like that. You cannot jump like that. God has anointed you and He wants to use your personality. Are you with me? You have an expression inside of you that only you can express and release. When you get to the place where you experience the fear of man, you cannot express. The enemy is not scared of your house and your car. The enemy is scared of your calling. He's scared of the anointing of God on your calling. And he's scared of obedience. So when you start to operate in your calling and the anointing of God comes upon you and you start to be obedient, you're going to move mountains. So the enemy is not scared of lukewarm. By the way, when we read the Bible, there's three measures. That's hot, lukewarm, and cold. But nowadays, we've become so technical that people would say, I'm not lukewarm, but I'm not hot. So maybe I'm 55 degrees on this side. There's three. Hot, lukewarm, cold. If that's the way you're arguing, you've become lukewarm and you are in a compromised, backslid position. We are called to burn with the fire of God. He says if you're lukewarm, he's going to spit you out of his mouth. Now watch what Paul says. They need to be strengthened. They need to be strengthened with might. Why? That Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Now the Bible says faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not yet seen. So which one comes first, faith or hope? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The Bible says in John chapter number 14, it says, don't be troubled or afraid. He says, because I will give you peace of heart and peace of mind. So what the enemy does is he's after our hope. Because if you don't have hope, your faith is not going to work. Peace of mind and peace of heart can only be given in the kingdom of God through the Holy Spirit. Because the Bible says the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. In the kingdom through the Holy Spirit. So that's why when people don't have peace of mind, peace of heart, they go to many things and many places because they're trying to get the peace and the hope which is only in the kingdom, and what you find in the world is a counterfeit. That's why you have to go back and back and back. And when you use some substances, you know that every time someone uses a substance, they have to the second time get something stronger to wish that they have the first kick that they had the first time. Peace and hope and joy is only in the kingdom of God. Now he says, Father, that, now listen, that you might be rooted and grounded in love. This is the one sentence in the Bible that I want to bring emphasis to this evening, that you may stay rooted and grounded in love. Why is this important? Father, would you give to them? Would you strengthen them in the inner man through your Holy Spirit with might that they can stay rooted and grounded in love? Why is that? Then it says, so that you can comprehend, that you can begrijp how big, how wide, how great his love is. Why? Then it goes further. He says, now to them who is exceedingly abundantly to do far than they can think, dream, or imagine. You can only do far more than you can think, dream, or imagine when you stay rooted in the love of Jesus. How many of you know, and this is a lesson, and this is something that I've experienced in my life. When you ask for something and God starts to give you that, God's not going to give you something that's going to take you out of his love, because you need to be rooted and grounded in love, because when you stay rooted, that will be your internal motivation of why you do what you do. When you wake up in the morning, you have to be rooted and grounded. And I got myself last year in a position, and this is what I want to really release tonight. As I was ministering and going through the motions and trusting the Lord for bigger and greater and more, all of a sudden, platforms started to open. All of a sudden, invitations started to become more. So there was a very fast pace of acceleration that took place. So when that happened, many things took place. You can ask my wife, for many years when I minister, when I come off the platform, I would go home and cry and say, I can't. That one lady got a touch. that one that got baptized, I would go home and I would cry and say, they had such beautiful encounters with the Lord. But in the middle of last year, as I came off a platform, the first question that came to my mind was that good enough? When I asked myself that question, I realized that something was wrong. I went to my wife, I phoned my dad, I said, I don't know what's going on. In that moment, I started to preach. I went on invitation after invitation. Things are getting faster, things are getting bigger. And I remember I got myself in a meeting where I was preaching, the power of God came in. I was so happy. The power came in so strong that in that moment, arrogance just started to come up. God is moving. Arrogance started to hit me, and I heard the words, the Lord asked me a question while I'm ministering. He says, Werner, what do you love more? Preaching or my presence? In that moment, I realized that I've become more in love with the assignment and mission than the one who has given me that mission, the one who has given me that assignment. And I realized that I'm in trouble, and I had to take off for 2 months. I just took off. And I want to show you something tonight about the anointing of God, because I believe this is the word I received for this year. I believe God wants to anoint the church more than ever. But I want to show you something about the anointing. Because He wants to anoint the church, but He cannot anoint you and give you what you want if you're going to lose focus. And if you don't stay rooted and grounded, because He's such a God that loves you so much that even when you lose focus, because He has anointed you, He's going to honor His anointing. So when God anoints you, you can be dangerous in the world, and you can also then become dangerous to yourself. I've learned a very valuable lesson. Never judge someone if you haven't been in their shoes. You don't know what level of demonic influence they have to deal with. And I remember when years ago I used to judge men of God and say, how can they do that in their ministries? Now, years later, I'm doing the very same things. Never judge someone if you've never been in their shoes. So I want to show you something the Lord showed me, and I really believe this is going to bless you tonight. Are you still okay? And I really believe God's going to move tonight. Is it okay met julle? Ons is in Kimberley, by Kimberley se groot gat. Tannie, mag ek 'n bietjie water vat? Kan ek 'n bietjie water vat? Dankie. Halleluja. Now, I want to show you something. Ek moet 'n storie vertel net om julle los te kry in Kimberley. Before I tell you something, maybe I must tell you die pikke wyn story. Henk, so one day I'm preaching in Holland and I'm busy. So when you preach in Holland, you have an interpreter. Weet jy wat dit is? It's a talk. So you speak and then you wait, then they interpret. So now is it Hollands. Broken English in Hollands. So I'm preaching and I'm busy, passionate, and I'm busy shouting at the people in Holland. And I said, the religious spirit. The moment I said the religious spirit, my interpreter said, die pikke wyngees. So I got a shock. I thought maybe he didn't hear me properly. So I said the religious spirit. He said, yes, the penguin spirit. So I thought, what is this guy about penguin spirit? I don't know what's going on here. So the next day, I thought about it. Why do they say penguin spirit? Have you ever seen a penguin? Jy het pikke wyn al gesien? Ek weet, dalk het jy al pikke wyn gesien. Jy het gesien 'n loop op pikkewyn. Pikkewyn, weet jy wat nee, hier in Kimberley het ons 'n tipe slang. Toe ek nou deel van die gangs was, nee. You put your one hand in your pocket and the one foot doesn't lift the floor and then you lie back into it. So when I was a wannabe gangster in Kimberley, this is how we walked. You don't lift that left leg, it just follows along. So many people come to church like a pikkewyn. So they have their little walk, they have their little slang, they speak a certain way, but the moment they come into church, all of a sudden they turn into a penguin. Het jy gesien hy das wat 'n pikke wyn op het? So he walks like this into a church. Oh Jesus, we love you. So you ask him, how are you? They start singing, hallelujah. Have you seen that? The Lord said many people come to church like penguins. Because Jesus, now zoom this penguin, let me show you this penguin. It can move, is that right? But not very fast. It's going somewhere, but very slowly. We are not called to just move a little and be a little. Is hier lou warm geroepie. But that penguin, there's a moment that penguin comes to the water. Have you seen that? When that penguin touches the water, all of a sudden, shoop, there's movement. The Lord showed me, said, many people come to church like a penguin. I'm forgiven. Hallelujah. Ooh. Says, I've not just come to forgive your sins. I've come to set you free. But then I've come to fill you with the Holy Ghost so that you can move. So that you can be effective. Are you with me? So God wants to anoint us so that we can move in the kingdom of God. Because if there's one thing of the kingdom that we have to know, is the kingdom does not work automatically. I've learned that there are things that God has given us, and the only way to get what He has given us is we have to enforce what He has given us. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He comes to give us life. So we have to enforce what He has given us. Now, when John chapter number 20, verse 21, Jesus comes and He says, receive the Holy Spirit. And then He went, whoosh. In that moment you receive the Holy Spirit, three things happen. Number one, the mission of Jesus becomes your mission. Jesus is still doing on this earth what He did when He was walking here. But now He's doing it through me and you. Because now He said, it's better that I leave, that I can give you something. I can give you someone. I can give you the Holy Spirit. Who's the Holy Spirit? I've learned this from a friend. It's Jesus without a body. Why doesn't He have a body? Because He wants to live in yours. Number two, what happens is you become the destroyer. Because the Son of God has come to destroy the works of the enemy. Now it's our privilege to enforce, to destroy. Because the Bible says, fight the good fight of faith. There's a fight you have to fight. It's not just going to work. You got to enforce the victory. Number three, He gives us the keys to the kingdom. So in other words, God wants to give us an anointing. He wants to enlarge us. He wants to use us. He wants to anoint us. And then you need to realize something. The Lord showed me in Psalm chapter number 24. Do you know that scripture that you are seated at the table while you feast in the midst of your enemies? Because He anoints your head, your cup overflows. So I read that scripture. I said, that's nice. My enemies can watch me as I am having a feast. But then I heard the Lord say, Werner, that's not what is happening there. He said, Werner, because I anoint you, you have to look in my eyes. You have to stay focused. Because when I anoint you, let me ask you this question. Have you ever been to a Christmas dinner with extended family? Aangetroude familie. Was jy al by kersete? So the moment you get there, I don't know if this has happened to you. The moment you get there, you just introduce yourself. You go sit at the table and all of a sudden they just don't like you. You've not even said anything. They just don't like you. Do you know why that is? It's because of the anointing. Some of you say, hallelujah, that makes sense. So God wants to anoint you, but I want to show you a pattern, what happens, and I believe this is the word that I received for this season for the church, and I want to show you a pattern in Mark chapter number 1, what happens when God anoints you and He enlarges your territory. Everyone say, God wants to use me. Some of you are not saying that. I said, God wants to use you. Is He wakker vanavond? So the first thing that happens, Mark chapter number 1, Jesus comes to John the Baptist. He says, John, you got to baptize me. The heavens open. Bible says Holy Spirit came down in the form of a dove. And He settled on Jesus. You with me? We need to know the Bible says something else. He says, in the last days, many will have a form of godliness. but they will deny the power. And then he says, stay away from them. Stay away from them who has the form. The Bible says in Luke 41, 49, he says, wait in the city of Jerusalem until you are endured with power. Then in Acts chapter number 2, suddenly what happened? A wind, a sound, and the Holy Spirit was poured out. And then they said, but these guys are drunk. Then Peter stood up, he said, they are not drunk as you suppose. He said, this was prophesied by the prophet Joel. In the last days, he will pour his spirit on all flesh. Prophet Joel said, the bar is open, come drink. It is available. Because the Bible says, those who are thirsty, come and drink, and out of your innermost being will flow rivers. The Bible says, don't get drunk on wine, but get filled with the Holy Spirit. So there's new wine available, and many has not been drinking the new wine, they've only been sucking the vinegar. Hulle is bietjie bitter. Die hulle asyn gedrink. Hulle is 'n bietjie suur. All you hear is criticism. They've received the ministry of criticism. Their whole ministry is to criticize. All they can do is, that's wrong. They are like a Pharisee. You know what a Pharisee is? A Pharisee is someone that always looks with an observing eye. The Bible says in Mark, I think, chapter number 7 or 8, they came to Jesus, they said, how come your disciples does not follow our rituals and that has been passed over by the forefathers? Jesus said, I've heard about you. They believed back then that you have to wash your hands up into your elbow. That was the tradition. That was their ritual. So they say, how come your disciples does not follow that? Jesus said, I've heard about you. He said, Isaiah prophesied and said, you can honor me. You guys honor me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. In the Passion Translation, then it says, their worship is like a charade. Their worship is like a show. Their worship is like an act. They worship worship. They just want to be seen worshiping. The act of worship. They worship with the lips, but the hearts are far from Him. I remember when I was so professional last year. I remember I came home in Ommen, in Drachten. I put my earphones on and I was walking in the road crying, saying, Lord, I'm sorry. I don't know what to do. I just felt that arrogance come upon me. And I remember the Lord showed me when I was younger, here in Diamantfeld Hoërskool, I was quite good with arm wrestling. Now, I was not too bad. Eh? I'm quite a man with humility, but I was all right back then. My shoulders were big. And I remember this young man coming to me. He says, let's arm wrestle. I said, brother, just go watch Seven Alarm or relax. I'm going to break your arm. Just calm down a bit. And he said, in front of everyone, he said, let's go for it. So I said, okay, let's do it. And like 2 seconds, choop, he just almost broke my arm. And as I'm walking, I'm praying, the Lord said, Werner, don't be like someone who speaks how big and strong and mighty you are, but when it comes to the push, there's no power. He says, rather be that skinny man. He says, you don't talk a lot, but when it comes to the push, there's power. Don't be someone that speaks with your lips. Be someone that walks the walk. Don't be someone that just talks the talk. When it comes to power, when it comes to crunch time, what is inside of you? Do you have a lifestyle following the King of Kings? Do you wake up in the morning with a song in your heart saying, Lord, I'm rooted and grounded in your love. I need more. I need more. I want more. I desire more. Here is my life. Use me. Is that you? I pray that He places the gift of hunger upon us tonight. Now, what happens here? So we get baptized, comes out of the water. What is the first thing that happens? He goes into the wilderness, and guess who shows up? His enemy. When God anoints your life, the first thing that's going to show up is your enemies. Second thing, what happens? So Jesus comes out of the wilderness. I'm not going to read it for the sake of time. He walks past a couple of fishermen. He walks past them and he says, follow me. imagine that fisherman's wife. Now, I don't know about you, but back then when I was working, my wife said, you come home when there's food on the table. So if you have to work 2-3 days, you come home with something. They're busy catching fish. Jesus walks by, he says, come, follow me. They leave everything and they follow him. Why? Number one, his enemy showed up. Number two, when God anoints your life, he gives you influence. Influence to such a place where you can even affect someone's destiny. They were fishermen. He said, come, follow me. Everything changed. What happened after that? Jesus begins his ministry in Galilee. Now, after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee, preaching the kingdom. Can you just watch this? Preaching not the 5 eschatologies of end times. He was preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. He wasn't preaching, God loves you, you're going to make it. He said, repent, for the kingdom is at hand. So his enemy showed up, you get influence, and when you make the main thing, I believe this season that we're entering in, we're going to see the simplicity of the gospel working again. Do you know what the enemy is fearful of? You know what he's the most fearful of? That's the Great Commission. Because if we don't win souls, then the time gets delayed. And then he has more time. The Bible says in Revelation that his time is running out. The Bible says that the kingdom is now. Salvation is now. Revelation 12 verse 10. It says the kingdom is now. Power is now. The kingdom is now. And then it says, the enemy knows his time is limited. It's running out. But we got to have a heart for the simplicity of the gospel so that the word can work. Now watch what happens. Fishermen, they followed him. Verse number 21, I want to show you something. Then they went into Capernaum. And immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and he began to talk. To teach. Taught, teach, leer. Now watch this. This was every Friday. Like we have Sundays, every Friday in that synagogue, they would come time after time after time. But this specific time, after he received the Holy Spirit, after he was anointed, the Bible says this. And they were astonished at his teaching. For he taught as someone having authority and not just as the scribes. I want you to see this. This specific time. Now, there was a man in the synagogue with an unclean spirit. They were committed back then. That man with that unclean spirit was probably there every Friday. But this specific time, watch what happens. And I want you to hear this. The unclean spirit cried out and say, let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know you are the Holy One of God. Now these demons were so clever, they recognized he was the Messiah. And the people there didn't even know he's the Messiah. He was preaching as someone with authority. He didn't speak to the demon. The demon responded because of what he carried and cried out and said, leave us alone. In other words, what he was carrying was disrupting them. It was disturbing them to the point where they had to cry out and say, leave us. And they recognized something. And this is what I want you to see. How did Jesus respond? But Jesus rebuked him, saying, be quiet and come out of him. Jesus didn't go, how long have you been here? Just change that camera angle quickly. How long have you been here? Why have you come? I'm touching on something here. It's not my opinion. This is the word of God. I want to show you something. He said, be quiet. Leave them alone. Watch this. And when the unclean spirit had convulsed and cried out with a loud voice, he came out of him. Then they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, what is this? What new doctrine is this? For with what authority he commands the unclean spirits, and they obey him. Now watch what happens. And immediately, onmiddellik, his fame spread out the region of Galilee. His fame didn't spread because he posted on Instagram. His fame didn't spread because he made a quick video of someone manifesting a demon and said, look at what we are doing. I'm touching a subject here. We don't speak to demons. If we speak to demons, it is not for the reason of entertainment. It is for the reason of interrogation or for training purposes. This started to work something in me. I said, Lord, I don't understand this. Something must be off. I was someone going, how long have you been here? So I'm not speaking as someone who is not casting out demons. I've been doing it for many years. So if I did not cast out demons, I don't have a say, but I have fruit to back me up in the subject. And I want you to hear this. His fame spread because he preached the kingdom of God. His fame spread because he carried something. There's once in the Bible recorded where he spoke to demons. He asked them a question. They said, we are many. He did not use the information to get the person free. Let me make it more clear, because I prayed about it. I said, Lord, I don't understand this show. Why do we give the enemy a platform? If we focus on what the enemy's name is and what his name is not, and how he came in and what he can do and what he can't do, then we let the enemy set the agenda, and he's not worthy of that. He's a defeated foe, and he's supposed to be under our feet. And then I heard something. I heard the Holy Spirit say, if your daughter is dirty, if you're going to wash her and get her clean, you're not going to record that. You're going to record when she's clean. We celebrate the freedom, and we don't give airtime where airtime is not due. Are you with me? Let that sink in for a second. If I'm wrong, prove me wrong. Because the only one on show is the King of Kings. The only thing I care about, I don't care what's his name, what's a demon's name or not. What I care about, the Spirit of the Lord cast it out every single time, and he changes the person. That's a mighty God we serve. What happens after that? Peter's mom-in-law was sick. Jesus was so faithful with what God has given him that he went to the one. He went to the mom got healed. What happened when you are faithful with the little that God gives you? He wants to anoint you. Your enemies are going to show up. Are you with me? When you preach the kingdom of God, after he's been faithful with the one, at evening, when the sun had set, they brought to him all who were sick and those who were demon-possessed. And the whole city gathered at his door. Die hele dorp het daar gestaan, because he was faithful. Then he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he did not allow the demons to speak because they knew him. If you know who you are, and you know whose you are, and you know who you carry, and you know not just the power of the name, but you carry the authority because you have a relationship with the Father, then the power will not just flow from speaking the name, it will come out of the place of walking in authority. Then you don't have to allow them to speak. You say, get out in Jesus' mighty name. That's when we go to the scripture, sons of Sceva. You know what happened there? They tried to cast out the demon. The demon said, I've heard about Paul. I know Jesus. Who are you? What they were actually saying is, what power are you using without the authority? That's when we get to the scripture where I've become so professional last year. Say, my son, say, you come there, he says, you've done great things. You casted out demons, but I don't know you. If there's two things, I'm walking with a dear friend sitting here tonight with Neil Pretorius from Hunger and Thirst. And the theme for this is hunger and thirst. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, they will be filled. Now watch this. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I feel the presence coming now. Thank you, Holy Ghost. There's two things that's needed. It's a lifestyle. It's the fear of God. When we fear God, we're not going to preach hyper grace. The teachings I'm hearing nowadays is when you give your heart to the Lord, nothing can snatch you from His hand. Yes, the enemy can't, but you can take yourself out of that hand. When we fear God, are you still okay? Are you still okay tonight? What we're preaching nowadays is don't become familiar with the man of God because then you can't receive from him. What we used to preach, what I've heard is when they came to arrest Jesus, Judas came and he said, I will show you which one is Jesus. Because they couldn't recognize him. And people would preach and say, because he was hanging out with the sinners, they couldn't recognize him. I was on the airplane. I heard the Lord say, that's not what's happening there. He says they couldn't recognize Jesus because they were so familiar with him every single day that they turned more into him. They started to change because he was rubbing off on them. Do you have a lifestyle that is provoking in such a way that you carry, you walk into places and spaces and atmospheres and people can feel the oil dripping from you? Let's not go further. Let me get you hunger. When I read the story of William Seymour in 1904, a black man with one eye, he was not even allowed to go into the church. He was sitting at the door of the church with the white man preaching. He said, Lord, I want to speak in tongues. He had such a hunger, such a fear of God. That man had such a big encounter that the history book said that he feared God in such a way he would put a box on his head before he started to preach. He would not take that box off before God says, take it off. It's recorded that he would stand sometimes for many hours until he hears, take it off. Then he would take it off. But because he was walking in such intimacy, had such a relationship and hunger for him, when he took the box off, the glory came in so heavy in that place that the kids were playing hide and seek in the thickness of the glory. Now don't tell me that's not available. Don't tell me the latter is greater. We're supposed to go from glory to glory. Maybe if I can just provoke some hunger in you tonight. To get to that place where we are hungry because we have become lukewarm. We have become complacent. We have become familiar. We have to fear the Lord God Almighty because He's our God. Yes, he's our friend. Yes, he's our daddy. Yes, all of that, but he is still the master. And we have to live life surrendered to the King of Kings. Then we can't make excuses of hyper grace and this and that. When God says it, we do it. There is an obedience required. It's going to cost you something. That man, I think it was Smith Wigglesworth. They knock on his door. The guy had a newspaper under his arm. He said, "Can I help you?" He said, "Yes, I want to visit you." He said, "What's that under your arm?" He says, "It's a newspaper." That man had such a fear of God. He said, "You're not coming in with that worldly news." That was the very man that when the ministers came to a prayer meeting with him, he had such a deep relationship with the master that when he started to pray and the glory of God started to come in, one by one, they had to leave. When I read that book, he says there were one time that he opened his eyes and he saw, "But I'm alone." And then he recorded that it came so heavy that he had to crawl out of his own office because of the holiness of God that came into the room. I'm sharing with you, when I found myself in Douglas in the Northern Cape, I had my little guitar with me. I said, "Lord, I want to see your heart." I started to become so desperate. This was years ago. I said, "Lord, I want to see your heart. I want to know your heart. Show me your heart." In one moment, it felt like the doors opened up. It felt like he started to walk closer and closer and closer. In that moment, I fell over on my new guitar. My own hands had to hide my eyes. And I burst all of the veins in both of my eyes because of the pressure and intensity of the fear of God that walked into that room. When he came closer, every fiber of my being was saying, "Can you please come closer?" But I knew and felt if he came closer, I would have exploded. For hours, I was lying on the floor, hiding my face. Eventually, it felt like he started to walk away, and I got up and I was crying hours upon hours upon hours. And I heard the voice of the Lord. He said, "Werner, you asked me to show you my heart." He says, "Tonight, I'm showing you how I cry over the lost." He said, "If I had to show you more, you wouldn't be able to handle it, and you would have died." And I remember back then, I had a respect, I had a fear. Last year, I became professional. I started to preach more eloquently. I started to see the gift operate, but yet I'm speaking about the river, but I'm not in the river. I started to speak about the love of Jesus, and there's no tears in the eyes. I started to become dry, but still he heals them. But still they come to him. But still he comes. And he blesses them. That's why I'm saying, and I'm challenging you tonight, are you staying rooted and grounded in his love? I almost lost it. If I didn't have people in my life to pull me out of that situation and say, "Get back, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, you and him." The first time I canceled everything, the first morning I walked into that prayer room, I started to perform, "Rabba Shakata Rabba." I heard, "Keep quiet." And all I heard, he said, "I just want to be with you." And I realized the creator of heaven and earth that created everything was missing me just being with him. How is that even possible? And I remember, as I was sitting there crying after I heard this, I walked back out of my prayer room just to get another cup of coffee. And I remember when I went back into that prayer room, it was not like he came into the room. It was like he was waiting for me. In that moment, I had earphones on. And I was listening to a song. And I was just sitting with him. And for one moment, this song, this lady hit a false note. I almost got such a big fright that I thought I have to cast out a demon or something. And in that experience, I heard the Lord speak to me. He says, Werner, when you stay intimate with me and you stay in my flow, he says, you are singing the song of heaven. You're releasing on earth as it is in heaven. He says, but when you start to lose focus, you're still singing a song. And I still love the people. Your gift and ability is still working. But you're not singing heaven's song. And the atmosphere is not coming into the building. It's merely your gift coming in. We have to be people that walk with intimacy. We have to love him. We have to be rooted and grounded in his love. If this is a word I can provoke tonight, is to be rooted. It is the foundation of everything. We are called to preach the simplicity of the gospel. We are on a mission. When he said, preach the gospel to the whole creation, he said, disrupt the systems. Is your life being a disruption? Let's go one or two scriptures, then we're going to end it off. Are you still okay? Thank you, Jesus. We honor you tonight, Father. I want to show you something in Acts 4. This changed my life. Excuse me, I don't know why my nose is crying as well. Everything is crying. Hallelujah. Peter and John. I want to preach the gospel for 1 second. Give me 10 minutes. We're going to make an altar call. The Spirit of the Lord is going to move tonight. Okay. Peter and John comes. They preach. They get in trouble. So I'm going to paraphrase so we don't have to go through the whole thing. You have some time? No, I'm joking. Okay, so they brought disruption because they were preaching the gospel. They were brought into custody. Signs and wonders started to break out. Is your life bringing disruption? Wherever you go, is your life provoking something? When you walk into atmospheres where, I remember this one time, let me go into the story. We had an encounter venue in Jeffreys Bay in the middle of 5 pubs. At the bottom of our venue was an adult store. Next to it, they were smoking weird, funny stuff. I remember the next day, all of the 5 tenants used the same bathroom. I remember as I was about to go into the bathroom, because of the evenings we started to have, there was a clash between light and darkness. The adult store, he's the owner of that store, his business started to be affected. And I remember as I wanted to go to the toilet, he said, I'm going first. I said, for sure. So I waited. When he finished, as I was about to enter, I realized this guy made a mess. But he made it on purpose. In that moment, I said, I'll pay anyone, any amount of money to clean this. I'm not doing it. As I turned around, I heard the Spirit of the Lord say, Werner, clean it. I said, Lord, no, it's impossible. I was standing there, but I knew I heard his voice. He said, Werner, clean it. He made a mess on purpose. I said, Lord, I want to be obedient. I started to clean. And I remember, as I walked out of that toilet, just as I took the first step, I heard the Holy Spirit say, Werner, he says, if you are willing and atmospheres are dirty and worldly and smelly, he says, get yourself out of the picture. If you are willing, I'll use you to change that very atmosphere. Is your life bringing disruption? Now they're preaching the gospel. The Bible says, verse number 4, however many of them heard the word and believed. And the number of men came to be about 5,000. They heard the word and they believed. The word of God needs to be preached. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing the word of God. People say, but we love Jesus. I hear what you're saying. In your 40 years of loving Jesus, how many people have surrendered their lives to Jesus? The Bible says, how beautiful is the feet of those who bring the good news. Verse number 7, let's go there. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked them a question. Remember, they brought disruption. They were preaching the gospel. People started to get healed. Watch what happened. They asked them a question. And I want you to see this tonight. They said, by what power or by what name have you done this? What is the intention? What is the internal motive of Peter and John doing what they are doing? And I want you to see this answer. Peter answered, the Bible says, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we have done this and is judged for the good deeds we have done to this helpless man, because the man got healed, by what means we have been made well? Now watch here. Here they expose the intention. He comes under the influence of the Holy Spirit and he says, let it be known. Let it be known to all and to the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here. The intention of their heart was exposed. He said, let it be known that by that name, this is why I'm doing what I am doing, filled with the Holy Spirit. And then watch this. Woo. Then it says in verse chapter number 12, nor is there salvation in any other name. Now I feel a preaching anointing. Nou gaan ek hierdie saak preek. Mag ek preek? Hallelujah. Ons het nou geteach, nou gaan ons preek. Kom broer, Pinkster gaan nou inskop hier. So is julle nog okay? Ons gaan hom nou eindig. We almost there. Nor is there any other name. Daar's een naam. He made it easy. In Dubai, the man said, we serve the same God. We just go different ways. No, there's one name. It is Jesus. He's the way, the truth, and the life. Een deur. Jesus Christus. Woo! Now when they saw the boldness on Peter. When they saw the boldness and Peter and John, they perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, and they marveled because they realized that these men have been with Jesus. They did not marvel because of their professionalism. They marveled because they recognized something. They felt something. They saw something. They experienced something when these guys came into their midst. Then it goes further. It says this. Verse number 14, and seeing the man who had been healed standing with them. When you walk in the things of God, you surrender your life completely, people are going to see the evidence. They're going to see something different. You can't argue with evidence. Let's go verse number 16. Saying, oh, watch this. They were saying, what shall we do with these men? What shall we do with Peter and John? In other words, they became a problem. When I read this, I said, Lord, I want to be a problem. When last have you been a problem? When last have you walked into religious systems, religious atmospheres, and you've become a problem because you've been set free? I want my life to become a problem. I want to be a problem when I walk into dry and dead and lukewarm, religious thinking, stinking thinking atmospheres. I want to come into with the life of the kingdom. Because last time I checked, he said, I'll give you life. He didn't stop there. Abundantly. Life looks like something. Life doesn't look like depression. Life doesn't look like anxiety. Life doesn't look like a life full of fear. If you have fear, it means you're not carrying the fear of God. It's a counterfeit of the real fear, which is the fear of God. That's why there's space for other fears. Are you with me? They became a problem. What shall we do with these men? They said. Then they commanded them to stop. Let me just end it off for you. Then they responded and said, listen here, if God was standing here and you were standing here, would I listen to you or would I listen to God? John and Peter were sarcastic. And then they said something. We cannot but help to speak of the things that we have seen and the things that we have heard. Are you speaking of the things you've seen? If there's one thing tonight I want to leave with you, don't lose your innocence. If there's advice I can give you as a young man that I'm facing every day of my life, I'm not praying and saying, Lord, anoint me more. I'm anointed man of God. You are anointed. I'm praying, Lord, help me to stay innocent. I'm saying, Lord, help me to stay pure. Because when the platform gets bigger, when the finances on the businessman gets bigger, help me to keep my innocence and stay pure. So that I don't lose focus and stay rooted and grounded in love. So that my motivation for doing what I'm doing will always be, let it be known that by that name we are making money and enforcing the kingdom of God. Be careful what you wish for. Is jy nog okay? Mag ek iets stamp vanaand in jou? Mag ons iets skud in ons? Laat ons brand met Jesus Christus. Dat ons so vol van die vuur is, ons geen plek vir louwarm. Wie drink louwarm koffie? Mag ons brand. Mag ons brand met sy vuur. Let me end with a last scripture. Can I have 5 last scriptures? Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. The Bible says, we must be a living sacrifice. Romans chapter number 12. He says, we must be a living sacrifice because of all that God has done for us. He says, this is truly the way to worship Him. How do we worship Him? When we become a living sacrifice. In other words, when we give ourselves, when we turn, not praise, hallelujah, sing a little louder, louder than the unbelief, louder than the what? Louder than the unbelief. A living sacrifice. When you turn, when you make a decision, when you give yourself, when you lay yourself down, then you lay down on the altar and He sets you ablaze that you can burn with His holy fire. Doesn't matter how it looks, how it sounds. Doesn't matter if you bring disruption. Doesn't matter if you become the problem. You are more God-fearing than opinionated fearing, than the fear of God saying, sit still, don't raise your hand, you cannot dance. The enemy is not moved when you are lukewarm. It's when you stand up and you give yourself. You become loud because the Bible says He's given us a joyful noise. Not a dead sitting, lukewarm, dry as a stick noise. A noise has to be made. The Bible says, we are in a rejoicing season. Rejoicing looks like something, sounds like something. Turn, the veil is lifted. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is It's not saying where the Spirit is, now there's freedom. Because the Spirit is here, is everyone free? When you study this, it says where the Spirit of the Lord is, Lord, there is freedom. When you come under His Lordship, when you give yourself, that is the first thing. If you desire to follow me, what must you do? Deny yourself. Pick up your cross. Deny yourself. No, I want to be in charge. No, the Spirit has to be made Lord of your life. You come under His Lordship. When Paul had the encounter, he stood up in the encounter. He said, Lord. The Lord didn't say, I'm Lord. He recognized whatever this is. He was not the only one that fell, but he was the only one that connected to the source. And he came under the Lordship. He said, Lord, what must I do? He said, go. And as you go, I'm going to reveal more to you. In other words, as you go, you're going to have more encounters. And then later in that verse, we go to chapter number 24, 25. It is about 25 years later after he had that encounter. King Agrippa comes to him. Now Paul has been shipwrecked. Paul has been beaten. He's been in jail. He's been through all these things. King Agrippa. Koning Agrippa. Sê vir hom, my chom, het lyk my het 'n slegte tyd. Hy sê, kan ek jou saak vir jou veg? Maar jy moet my bietjie vertel van jou saak. With the same passion. He gives more detail to that encounter he had 24, 25 years later. With the same passion, he said, Koning Agrippa, jy verstaan nie wat my gebeur het. Daar was 'n lig, hy sla my blind. Van die perd af. Ek staan op, ek was verlore, ek het die almal gepersecute, ek het hulle doodgemaak. Op hy oomlik, sê Jesus vir my. And it says in English, it says more detail in the encounter. Die Here sê vir hom, I've blinded you and now I've opened your eyes, but now I need you to open the eyes of the other. In other words, he had the encounter, but now he became the encounter. Want nou maak hy die oë oop. Nou preach hy die gospel. Ons is geroep om gevaarlik te wees. Ek hoor nie amen genoeg hierso nie. Ek hoor nie halleluja genoeg hierso nie. Ek weet nie of jy gevaarlik of lou warm is nie. Maar maak 'n plan. Want is tyd om gevaarlik te wees vir die koning van die konings. Die tyd van die een man uur, one man show, is nie klaar nie, is nie verby nie. Tot die kerk wakker skrik en besef dat hy spoor die spirit on all flesh. En hy wil ons allemaal gebruik. En hy wil ons gevaarlik maak in elke facet van ons levens. Maar dan het ons nodig om ons persoonlikheid te gebruik. Dan het ons nodig om die fear of man af te kry. En dan het ons nodig om vir iets te staan. Want as jy nie vir iets staan, nie val jy vir enig iets. Dis tyd om 'n keuse te maak in jou lewe. Dis tyd om te sê, Here, hier is ek. It's time to lay it all down before the King of Kings. Is jy met my? Wel, ek was lou warm, ek het geperform en ek het bietjie teruggetrap daar. Bietjie fokus verloor, maar daar's genade. Maar dis tyd om staan op in daai encounter. Maar vanaand gaan 'n encounter, maar jy moet die encounter raak. Laaste noot wat ek voel ek moet gee, voor ek 'n slukkie water vat om net hierdie keel bietjie te laat loop. Lig is droog in Kimberley. Listen to this. I'm going to tell that story. I'm preaching in Drachten in Holland. We are supposed to have 3 meetings. The first meeting, the lady said, why does manifestations only happen in Africa? I say manifestations doesn't just happen in Africa, but don't chase the manifestation, chase God. That night we preach. 2/3 of the congregation started to manifest demons. I said, Chantel, help me. She's jumping over the chairs. We're just casting out demons. The next night she comes up, she says, God has never moved in our church in 35 years, but last night he showed up. We had 3 meetings. It turned into 15 meetings. The 15th meeting was the Sunday. The Lord said, it's not your meetings. Get out. I got out 2 weeks later. She phoned me. She said, the building is full. We just bought it cash. She said, and since that day, I'm preaching and I'm seeing signs, wonders, miracles. People are coming to Christ. 3 months later, she phones me. She said, we just got a new building because our building got too small. 400 people, she said, and it's too small again. Hallelujah. Hey. Hey. So in that revival, I'm preaching, my killer's droog. So then after the 15th meeting, you don't know what to preach. You just say anything. So there's a stage where like, Lord, I don't know all these things. I've not been to Bible school. I'm not qualified. I just open my Bible and I start to read and I hope I eat something. But the atmosphere is so thick and heavy. It's just there. I read anything. So I tell them a story. I said, yeah, last night was great. Went back at 2 a.m. in the morning and I just wanted a sandwich. I was hungry. So I stopped at the garage here in Holland. And I walk in and I see this beautiful sandwich. It looks so nice. I say, that chicken is staring at me. I'm just telling the story because I don't have anything else to preach. I'm out of stories. So I'm just telling it. And I say, yeah, I've got that sandwich and I got it. And I'm so hungry. I start to eat that sandwich and I can't swallow it because there's no sauce on it. It's the best looking sandwich I've ever seen, but it cannot go down. I'm suffocating. I'm almost dying in my own car. I don't have water. And it comes out of my mouth. And I say, many of the pastors here are like that sandwich. They look very nice and flashy. They preach a lot and we chow a bit, but it cannot come down because there's no Holy Spirit. There's only word, but no spirit. We need word and spirit so that we can, anyways. So last story. We're going to encounter God. Have you ever asked the question, why does people fall and roll and flip and jump? And sometimes we see it happens, but their lives never change. Have you ever had that question? Now, our ministry, we love encounters. I'm one of the rollers. Sometimes I roll, sometimes not. Sometimes I fall, sometimes not. I've learned, don't measure someone's maturity on how they manifest. Whether they fall, roll, stand still, you measure maturity on how you surrender to Him. Are you giving yourself? So I had this question. I said, Lord, there's some people, they're rolling, but nothing changed. What's happening? Now, I remember one day I went on a mission trip to Malawi, me and my wife. No, she was at home. So I went 2 weeks, and I really missed her. I came home. I was so tired. I missed her a lot. I sat on the couch. I said, my wifey. I said, have you missed me? She said, of course. So I want to ask you a question. Are you in love with me? My wife said, yes, yes, I like you. I said, my vrou, jy verstaan nie mooi wat ek vra dan nie. I said, are you in love with me? She says, yes, I love you. So I looked at her. And my wife knows I don't like feet. I don't like touching feet. I don't like staring at feet. I just don't like feet. So I said, give me your feet. I said, where's that Dove cream? So I start to work the feet. I'm busy with the feet. And that evening we went to bed. Early morning, I went into my prayer room, came out. My wife walks out of the room. She said, today I feel so in love. That moment the Lord spoke to me. He says, Werner, when you encounter me, He says, your container is only being stretched. He says, because when I anoint you, I fill you up, it overflows. When my power comes upon you, I am just increasing that container. He says, but that's not the oil. He says, the oil is when you sit at my feet. No one is watching. It's you and me. And we work the feet. When you are obedient. When you follow Him. Hallelujah. Last thing I have to say, and I'm going to say it. I've not turned into a prosperity preacher, but I preach prosperity in the sense that we have to prosper. Tonight you'll see I don't take any offering. We don't want an offering. We don't need an offering. We don't want an offering. I want to show you something about prosperity. Prosperity is something that belongs to someone who has a position that realize what is theirs and what belongs to them and what's been taken. Now in prosperity, I said, Lord, I want to see this prosperity thing. There are times where the Lord says, give, you give. There are times the Lord says things, you do those things. But I was standing in Holland one day and the worship leader was singing a song and he was saying, I went into the enemy's camp and I take back what he stole from me. the moment he sang that song, Holy Spirit spoke to me. He said, you're not just taking back what he stole from you. You're taking back what he stole from your dad. You're taking back what he stole from your grandfather. You've got some territory to take back that belongs to you. And I've realized that when it speaks about the fight of good faith, that we have to fight that fight, I've learned that that fight is a positional fight. It is just a position that you have to change. When you change a position and realize that my dad, my father, then you get to the place where you can command and enforce things. And I feel the enemy have stolen too much. There's some things stolen in your life. There's maybe some finances been stolen in your life. In the book of Acts, it says they lacked nothing. It was not just finances. It was health. There was no sickness. So there are some things that's been stolen from us. And we got to take it back. He's not going to give it back to you. He's given it already. So we have to realize it is ours. But if we're not going to take our rightful place as sons and daughters of the living God, using the delegated authority that has been given to open our mouths and speak to mountains, and mountains will move, then stay lukewarm, poor, depressed. Tonight we're not here to impart depression. We're not here to impart poverty. He says, leave an inheritance for your children's children. Go your calculator and work that out. That's what's available. It is ours. We have to enforce it by a position. Are you with me? I feel tonight we're going to speak some things in the atmosphere. Things have been stolen and it has to come back. This is house of restoration. We speak that things restore, but we also pray that it is beyond just restoring. It's now breaking ground. We even speak on this church where I grew up as a young man. Territory is enlarging. I feel to read the scripture. Where is that? Shakas Kataya. We end with the scripture. Isaiah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. 54, I think. Hallelujah. Verse number 2. Enlarge the place of your tent. And let them stretch out the curtains of your dwellings. Do not spare. Lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes. For you shall expand to the right and expand to the left. And your descendants will inherit the nations and make the desolate cities inhabited. Do not fear, for you will not be ashamed, neither be disgraced. For you will not be put to shame, for you will forget the shame of your youth. For you will forget the shame of your youth. I don't know how you grew up, but there's some stuff we got to take back. For you will forget the shame of your youth and will not remember the reproach of your widowed life anymore. For your maker is your husband, the Lord of hosts, his name, and your redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. He is called the God of the whole earth. Verse number 13, all your children shall be taught by the Lord. And great shall be the peace of your children. In righteousness you shall be established. You shall be far from oppression. For you shall not fear. And from terror, for it shall not come near your house. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. Jesus went to do good and he healed all those who were oppressed by the devil because God was with him. If there's poverty in your life, that is oppression. If there's sickness in your life, that is oppression. If you feel depressed, that is oppression. As I sang that song, I went into the enemy's camp and I take back. that specific service, I was supposed to preach the simplicity of the gospel, and I did. But as I preached, it was like something fell on me and everything changed after that one day. When it fell on me, the very next week, I'm invited, they bring me onto a platform. Now watch this. When I was in matric, I was supposed to be sportsman of the year. There were many bekertjies, medaljetjies ready for me. They said, you will not be allowed at the prize giving. It was taken away. When it was taken away, I opened up myself to a lie of the enemy, believing that I'm a failure. So when I give the enemy authority, obviously I'm going to be a failure because I had authority to be someone in victory, but I gave it away. So now he has the right to say failure. After that restoration took place, I was invited to go onto a platform. They came to me and say, we want to give you this qualification as an honorarium. We want to honor your work. As I got it, I knew that I do not deserve what I just got because you have to study 3 years for this thing. They just gave it to me. And as the hand was laid and I fell to the floor, the father said, remember when you were younger, something was stolen. It's time to pay back. He says, you do not deserve this, but I'm giving it to you. And then when I stood up, I felt as I went through life that things started to come easy. I felt there's a different flow. I don't have to work for things. It shows up. When you are anointed, you don't have to ask for things. It just comes when you need it. Are you with me? In Acts, when Paul was shipwrecked on the island of Malta, then as they were shipwrecked, they preached the gospel. They healed everyone on that island. His ship was destroyed. And then the Bible said they came to him and they supplied everything that he needed for the trip. In other words, if you preach the gospel, if you walk in your calling, if you are obedient to God, everything is going to show up. We are called to prosper. Here's the altar call. Hallelujah. We have to make an altar call. It's just part of my job description. Father, we thank you tonight. Thank you for the word. I want to ask you something before that. Keep your eyes closed. Think of the very three things in this sermon, in this message, three things that challenged you. Three things that stood out. What challenged you? If you don't know, ask Holy Spirit, which three things? And then you ask him, what should I change in my lifestyle? Where should I repent and get back on track? Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your presence in this building tonight. I saw the Lord seated on his throne. The first call I want to make, because I recognize there's people here I don't know. If you find yourself in a place where maybe you've become tired, maybe you've been operating and you just felt a pressure, you just felt, but momentum is not there. You just felt, but hey, afresh. I just want to give myself again. I just want to lay it all down again. I just want to get back to the basics again. I just want to love you again. I just want to sit with you again. Maybe you've been following him, but you just feel a weightiness, just a heaviness, just the lie of the enemy whispering in your ears. And tonight, I want to challenge you. I want to ask you if that's you. And you say, I just want to lay it down afresh. I want to surrender afresh. I want to challenge you right there where you are. Raise your hand. Say, that's me. I want you to thank you for those hands. Thank you. Thank you. Going up everywhere. If that's you, just raise your hand. Say, that's me. That's me. And I want to count to three. I want you to stand to your feet. Because when Jesus died on that cross, He did it publicly. He didn't do it in a closet where no one saw. He stood up because He loved us so much. And tonight we're going to stand up. I love it. Before I even say it, people stand up. I love that. I mean, you mean business tonight. Thank you. Standing up. If that's you, stand up tonight. I include this altar call. Everyone that just says, I'm going to make a stand. Maybe you've made a stand already, but you know there's deeper things. There's more available. But you want to align your life. Say, Father, here is everything. I lay myself on the altar. If you want to lay yourself down, say, everything, Father. If that is you, I want you also stand up. And stand up boldly. Stand up. As it jy is, staan op van ons. Jy sê, Here, ek gee alles uit. Ek gee my lewe vars. Gebruik my lewe, Here. Here, kom val met U teenwoordigheid op my. As dit jy is, staan op. Sê, Here, hier is ek. Kom verander my. Kom rus op my. Kom raak my. And then I want to ask if there is someone that I hear this is something that's going to shift tonight. You've been in a season, but you feel it's been delayed, it's been delayed, it's been delayed. You know it's a new season, but it feels like it's been delayed, it's been delayed, it's been delayed. You're entering a new season. If that's you, stand up. That's it's going to shift. If you see some dead spot in your business, you don't know what's happening. It's like the momentum is not there. I don't understand. It's stopping tonight. I'm telling you, I possess a key, and that is breakthrough. There's a key from heaven which is available to us, and He's going to release it supernaturally on your life. He's going to supernaturally release the breakthrough to enter into the greater, because He wants to make you greater. Because when you are greater, He is being exalted. He is getting the glory for your greatness, because He made you to be great. He did not make you to be average, lukewarm. And if you feel that there is no direction, I want you to stand up. And if you are on fire, you're burning for Jesus, but you simply says, I just want more, because there's always more. Just turn the heat up. If that is you, stand up boldly tonight. I'm standing myself saying, Father, set me ablaze tonight. Set me ablaze, Father. And I want you to raise your hands all over this building. Father, we speak over lives. Every oppression, every lie of the enemy, we break it now in the mighty name of Jesus. We speak the acceleration from heaven. Glory to glory to glory. I pray, Father, everything that's been slowing down, that's been hindering, in Jesus' name, the anointing breaks the yoke. Every yoke of bondage is being destroyed. This is the hour of the church. This is the hour of radical. This is the hour of burning with the Holy Ghost and fire and becoming problems to disrupt the worldly system. I thank you that you are anointing us afresh with the call, the Great Commission. And tonight you're empowering us. You're empowering us. You're empowering us. Just release your hands. Just raise it. Just stay in this atmosphere. Whew. And exalted I. We release your Holy Spirit. Touch. Feel. The temple, and the angels surround Him. Father, we release your presence. 3, 2, 1. Come and breathe. Come and move. Your presence. Your fire. Your anointing. Set our feet ablaze, Father. All over the building now. Touch. Rekesh Gataya. Thank you, Jesus. We surrender afresh. Thank you that we can be rooted and grounded. Thank you that even tonight you reveal your love to us at a deeper level, a greater level. Thank you, Jesus. Feel the anointing coming upon me. You feel that? Is it coming upon you? I pray, stir up hearts. For the sake of time, stay in this atmosphere. For the sake of time, I'm announcing the service is finished. Stay in the atmosphere. You feel you have to go, more than welcome to go. We bless you. We bless you for this week. I pray that God will give you visions, dreams, that He would enlighten the eye of your heart, but that He would place a burden of the gift of hunger, to hunger and thirst for Him. Then you're more than welcome to leave. If you're in this place, we're going to make an altar call in this building. You say, I want some of the SFM team, just the leadership, to come and help. I want you to be bold tonight and take another step. As you take that step, come forward. We're going to lay hands on people. We're going to minister to you. The power of God's going to touch you tonight. If that is you, you say, that's me. Get hungry, get thirsty, and come. Move forward. Come out of your seat. The altar is open. Then I want you to step out now boldly. Come forward. Let's go. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. I want the SFM team, if there's a prayer team, ministry team, please come with me. If you're leaving, bless you. Please respect those in front. Are we going to lay hands boldly tonight? You're believing for that breakthrough. We believe the power of God's going to fall on you. If you're hungry for more of Him, come forward. The spirit of revival is going to touch your life. Come forward. Come, let's go. Shekres Kataya. Rekes Kataya. Rokos Kataya. Come forward, close your eyes, open your heart. Don't wait for any man. Don't wait for any man. Can the ushers just help that they make two lines, maybe? Those coming, let them make another line, maybe. Just help them. In these moments, we honor the anointing. We honor His presence. We honor what He's doing. Hallelujah. 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 Just open your heart. Close their eyes. Before we lay hands, come. He wants to touch you tonight. Don't wait for any person. If there's one thing that He moves on, if you read the New Testament, when there was hunger, He would do simply things that He wouldn't do for those who are not hungry. I want you to get hungry for Him now. Here, ons het U lief. Here, ons love You. Here, ons love You. We love You, Jesus. We love You, Jesus. Thank You for Your presence. Even over this building. Everyone in front here, Father, release fire, fire, fire. The fire of the Holy Ghost begin to flow now. We release the anointing. I want some ushers. Can you just keep your eyes open? Some ushers to operate, to just help out a bit. Hallelujah. Fire, the fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire of the Holy Ghost. Thank You, Jesus. Set us ablaze tonight. In the mighty name of Jesus. Touch. All over, all over, all over. He's touching. There, He's moving. He's moving. He's moving. Fire of the Holy Ghost. There He goes. 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 There it is. There it is. The fire. The fire. The fire. Here it comes heavier now. The presence of the Almighty God breaking yokes. Every form of fear is being destroyed now. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Rekesh kataya. Lakas kataya. The fire. The anointing. There he goes. Someone's receiving freedom. Free in the mighty name of Jesus. I said free in the mighty name of Jesus. Free in the mighty name of Jesus. Release. Release every yoke of bondage. Free. 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 I said freedom in the mighty name of Jesus. Release. Release. All over this building. Oh, the anointing is coming. Oh, His presence is coming upon your life. Oh, He's marking you with His presence tonight. He's marking your life. We release a favor. A favor. A favor. A favor. Rekesh kataya. Open doors. Open doors. Geopende deure in die naam van Jesus. Maak het los. Maak het los. Maak het los. Maak het los. Shekres kataya. Fire. Fire. Can I have an usher of me? Fire. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Release. 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 Fire of the Holy Ghost. Release. The fire of the Holy Ghost all over this building. If you're sitting in your seat, I pray that it becomes hot. Oh, that it will burn you even in your seat. Release, release, release. The fire, the fire, the fire. The fire, the fire of the Holy Ghost. Rekenda bravas ketende. You worthy. There it is, there it is, there it is. There it is, there it is, there it is. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Rekeskataya. Rekeste. Fire. Rekeskataya. Kom eens. Sien Asher, korte Asher. Fire. Release. As die leadership saam, SFM bedien, bedien, bedien saam, Neil bedien saam. Release. Fire. 3, 2, 1. Release. More, more, more. Shekres kataya. Rekenda braste. Release. Fire. You deserve it all, Father. We give you the highest praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name. You deserve. Worthy is your name. Worthy is every form of sickness. Every form of sickness. You feel in your skouer. You feel in your skouer. Skouer raak nou genees. Skouer raak nou genees. Fire. Fire, fire, fire. Of the Holy Ghost. Fire, skouer, skouer. Ek hoor skouer, skouer. Fire. Touch. Fire, fire. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name. All the angels cry, oh. A deep encounter, Father. A deep encounter of glory and presence. Consume her heart tonight. Doesn't matter anything else. If you lost focus here or there, made a mistake here or there, He's jealous of your heart. And He's wrapping His presence around that heart. He says, this is a heart I love. And this heart, now increase that glory. Fire. Fire of the Holy Ghost. And I release a breakthrough atmosphere. I will come upon your life and your house. You will see the fruit and you will begin to attract heavenly breakthrough. You'll see it. You'll experience it. You will know, I don't deserve this. I don't know why it's happening. It's because He has your heart and He's bringing you to that worship, that sitting, that having a tea with Him and just sitting. You and Him. There's a lullaby melody that you have to release. The enemy wanted to steal your song. He wanted to steal your song. Enough is enough. Whew. Fire, fire, fire of the Holy Ghost. Deep is calling too deep. Fire. You will start many things. Start. I see start. Pioneer and start. Many things you'll be involved. 3 months, you're gone. Next thing. Something's longer, something shorter. New. The Lord gives you an anointing to see like in the big hole. You say, but there is still diamonds here. You thought there's no diamonds. The Lord will give you an eye to see opportunity where no one sees opportunity. He gives you an angle to see from a different way. I see that. Father, He will start many things. You will use Him to ignite and start many things and to start things in people to assist and help start. And say, we start this. Yes, we start that project there. Yes, this thing here. He's giving you an exceptional, I hear this word exceptional, I don't even use this word. He's giving you an exceptional weight of wisdom at a young age. Clearly, you'll just see, we need to do this here. It just makes sense. I don't know how I know this, I just know this. That wisdom and knowledge, revelation, we release upon his life, Father. Increase. Shebreskete, you will get a voice. Your voice has been quieted down. Your voice has been like this. I see your voice, you're speaking, and I see something being put on your voice. The Lord's restoring an authority of you using your voice. I see you standing up where you've been walking. You're talking, your words go down. There's no weight. He says, I'm lifting you up from now. There's weight. There's a standing up. There's a positional shift. And there will be weight on your words. There's taking back in the area of you being man. Things have been stolen. A position is being shifted tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Die vier. Ons release it. vyandse werk en leuns word gestop oor jare lewens. Shebreskataya braskata. Shebresketerebre. Julle sal staan op skouers. Julle sal hoogte sien wat min mense sien. Here, U bewaar hulle oë to see the spirit. Hey rakaskoto. Kom en nou, ek kom en nou, ek voel hy wil vir jou release. Hier kom 1, 2, 3, fire. Thank you, Holy Ghost. More. Dankie, Jesus. Ons maak het los vir haar. Spoel het deur. Die lieve dochter. Ja, halleluja. Yes. Increase het nou. In Jesus nou. Dankie, Jesus. O, Rabasketaya.
And greatly to be praised.
Touch.
I sing praises to your name. Oh, Lord.
Maak die salving nou los van haar kop tot haar tone. Dankie Here. Hierdie gedagtes wat haar klop besig. Hierdie gedagtes, elke vorm van doubt, Here, jy kom nou in die hart. En diep soek na diep. Touch. Release presence in haar en deur haar. In hierdie seisoen. Seën haar nou, Here. We love you. Wat die vyand gesteel het in julle lewens. Ons maak los 'n terugbetaal met 'n oes in die naam van Jesus. In die naam van Jesus.
Die vuur van God. Release dit. Die increase. Ek sê daai breakthrough. Ek sê daai sal wat trek. Wat trek, Vader? Daai nuwe hoogtes wat hy van gedroom het, daai nuwe hoogtes wat hy wil sien, daai nuwe hoogtes wat hy weet, as made for those higher heights. U maak dit vir hom los in hierdie seisoen, Here. Dit soek na hom nou. Release die vuur in the mighty name of Jesus. En op die aanval. Ek hoor dit kolskoot elke keer. Hy sê jou geweer se skote word nou 2 kliks, 3 kliks, nou sê kolskoot. Rambas keterebre in the mighty name.
Yes. For your name greatly to be praised. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I sing praises to your name. Het jy pyn in jou rug? Een kant. That side.
Release 3, 2, 1. Komt hier nou pyn in gang.
Healing anointing, I release it. Begin by gevoel om, toets om, free, it's gone, totally gone, glory to Jesus, now just touch him afresh, sê kresh katayas, iemand in hierdie plek, someone, jy kry maag, soos een naarheid, soos een maag, jy sit met 'n maag, ongemaklike maag van tyd tot tyd. Here wil jou genees. Here wil jou genees. Shek eskataya.
Give you all my
Of Holy Ghost, increase your the presence, the anointing that breaks every yoke of depression, every bondage is being broken and released. Jesus name, Jesus name, Jesus name, Jesus name, Jesus name.